Penguin Random House Audio presents Melting Pot or Civil War? A Son of Immigrants Makes the Case Against Open Borders. This is the author, Reihan Salam. To my sisters. Introduction. A few years ago, a cable news producer asked me to appear on his television program to discuss a grisly murder in which, if I recall correctly, a Muslim immigrant had hacked someone to death in the name of Islam. I begged off, partly because I had no special expertise in the matter. But as a professional pundit, that doesn't usually stop me. Not only would I have happily discussed a swing Senate race or corporate tax cuts, but if invited, I would also have gladly weighed in on the upcoming NATO military exercises in Romania or the latest developments in the Canadian-US softwood lumber dispute. Nevertheless, there was something about being asked to pontificate on this particular subject that gave me pause. Did my Muslim origin somehow make me an authority on terrorist violence? My opinions on Islamic extremism were, frankly, not all that unique. There were plenty of other journalists who knew far more about homegrown terrorism than I did, so I passed a few names along and politely declined to take part myself. Then, in December 2017, another terror attack took place. Only this time the culprit was someone who looked a lot like me. Akayed Ullah, a 27-year-old man born in Bangladesh, detonated a crudely designed explosive device in New York's Port Authority bus terminal, which sees more than 230,000 commuters every day. Thankfully, Ullah injured no one but himself. His intention, however, had evidently been to take as many of those commuters with him to the afterlife as he could. No one asked me to share my thoughts on the incident, which came as something of a relief. For a while, though, I could think of little else. In the days and weeks that followed, dogged reporters, in the United States and in Ullah's native Bangladesh, pieced together a troubling story. Though not notably radical before settling in Brooklyn in 2011, the young man had come to loathe America and to see his true home as with the Islamic State, a gang of zealots best known for its homicidal brutality. There was a sad irony in Ullah's devotion to IS. The Islamic State's propaganda insisted that it had built an egalitarian paradise where all Muslims were treated equally. In practice, while the terror group prized its European recruits and treated Arab volunteers relatively well, their African and South Asian counterparts, Bangladeshis very much included, were routinely treated as subhuman wretches. They were given the most dangerous assignments, the worst equipment, the lowest wages, and the lowest priority when it came to doling out jihadi war brides. Yet Ullah apparently concluded that innocent U.S. commuters, including any number of recent immigrants much like himself, deserved to be put to death to avenge America's war against the Islamic State. Why did I find Ullah's crime so affecting? For one, he lived in Kensington, the neighborhood where I grew up, and he was born in the same country as my parents. Ullah and I had shared the same stretches of sidewalk and probably frequented the same corner stores. He settled in the country legally via a green card sponsored by a family member, not an uncommon story among Bangladeshi immigrants. When I saw Ullah's face, I saw someone who could have been a cousin or who might have helped my mother carry an armload of groceries. After I heard the news, I girded myself for what would come next. In the age of Trump, all conversations about immigration descend into dueling spasms of culture war outrage. As a poor Muslim immigrant turned lone wolf terrorist, he was emblematic of some of the most polarizing aspects of the president's immigration agenda. Trump had famously campaigned on banning Muslim immigrants from the United States outright, a stance that enjoyed overwhelming support among GOP primary voters. As president, he called for curbing family-based admissions on the grounds that it meant admitting millions of immigrants lacking in merit. Immigration advocates pushed back. Some argued that it was obscene to suggest that a man like Ullah was representative of immigrants at large. Others said that it was racist to question our current approach to family-based admissions. And where was I? In an uncomfortable place. Donald Trump had built his political career on demonizing immigrants, and I sympathized with immigration advocates who resented him for it. I am not just the son of immigrants. I am the brother, neighbor, and friend of immigrants, many of whom found Trump's rhetoric frightening. to the extent I harbor stereotypes about immigrants, they're positive. Some immigrants are violent and cruel, and others are feckless and lazy, just as there are many millions of natives who suffer from similar failings. But few are, like Akayad Ullah, intent on mass slaughter. Consider that he was married to a woman still living in Bangladesh, and his wife had recently given birth to a son. She was applying for visas to join him in America. What could possibly have led him to bring such shame to his family members and to destroy their prospects of a better life? Surely something so personal and strange as to defy generalization or some specific public policy response. So you'd think my sympathies would be with America's growing army of open borders activists who call for ending all deportations and adopting ever more permissive immigration policies. Many of them are Americans like me, with recent immigration in their families, and I understand where they're coming from. But I noticed a contradiction in the arguments I was hearing for more open borders, which led me to part ways with the pro-immigration activists. There is a yawning chasm separating standard-issue immigration enthusiasts who insist with a straight face that more open immigration policies will have absolutely no negative consequences, and an emerging class of intellectuals I call the bullet biters. Serious, rigorous, thoughtful immigration advocates who recognize that if the United States is going to welcome a far larger number of low-skill immigrants, we Americans will have to transform our welfare state, and we might even have to countenance the creation of a new class of guest workers who would be permanently barred from citizenship. The bullet biters recognize that the world of the 2020s and 2030s will be drastically different from the world of the 1890s and 1900s. Not least because the number of potential migrants to America will have greatly increased. And they forthrightly acknowledge that open borders and domestic equality simply can't coexist. Their position, in essence, is that by welcoming millions of low-skill workers who'd never be in a position to enter the U.S. middle class, we would greatly reduce global inequality while enriching native-born citizens, who'd be in a position to employ vast numbers of low-wage helpers who could do menial jobs more cheaply and reliably than machines, at least until the machines get just a bit more sophisticated. Yes, this would mean the creation of an even more hierarchical society at home, but as far as the bullet biters are concerned, that would be a small price to pay. I will have more to say about the arguments made by the bullet biters in the chapters that follow. For now, though, I'll simply note that I found their case bracing and enlightening. It turns out that the standard-issue immigration activists, the ones who want more open immigration policies and a more equal society, or, in other words, who want to have their cake and eat it too, are crushingly naive. They haven't really thought through where their convictions are taking them. Which leads me back to Akayad Ullah. Though he was entirely unlike most immigrants in his hatefulness, there were other aspects of his story, or at least of what I could suss out, that were more familiar and that reflect exactly the problems that have made me question the wisdom of our immigration system. Though Ullah had lived in the United States since 2011, he never quite established himself. He reportedly drove livery cabs and did occasional work as an electrician. Having known many immigrants who have made a living in back-breaking service jobs, I can attest that not everyone is cut out for dealing with customers and bosses. For prideful men who are accustomed to ruling the roost, service work is an endless series of humiliations. Despite living in one of the world's most diverse cities, Ullah's social world appears to have been limited to its Bengali-speaking enclaves. Described as always angry by a neighbor, Ullah didn't make much of an effort to befriend anyone outside of his enclave. Understandably, he was in near constant contact by phone with his wife back home. Ullah's hatefulness and lurch toward violence were unusual. His struggles as an immigrant in a country that placed little value on his skills and abilities and that felt very far from home were not. These are familiar struggles for immigrants, most of them as nonviolent as you or me. The worst off of these struggling millions live in illegal basement apartments where they sleep in shifts, or in studios and one-bedroom apartments divvied up to accommodate 5 or 6 people in conditions that resemble the tenements of yesteryear or the teeming cities of the developing world. The very things that can make such a life easier to endure being surrounded by co-ethnics who speak your native language, clinging tightly to loved ones back home, are often what keeps you on the margins. As far as the bullet biters are concerned, this is perfectly fine. Immigrant poverty might be aesthetically displeasing, but these people are better off in absolute terms than they would be at home, and that is all that matters.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.